morning, RHCC. It's great to be with you today. As we worship, we are looking forward to hearing God's word. And I'd like to share a prayer with you as we begin our service today. Let's pray. Father, we fix our eyes on you, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Come and fill our hearts with your endless love and send the wind of your Holy Spirit to blow new hope through our lives. Father, we ask that you will light up our souls to rise in faith, to stretch out and take in your kingdom. Father, come pour out your Spirit upon us as we stand together, as your brothers and sisters. Father, we ask that you will brush away the shadows of guilt and shine your grace into our minds. Father, we again are not together, but we arise to worship you. We shake off those shackles. We shake off the fallen world. And we join in singing your praises this morning. We will continue to declare your goodness. And so, Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity that we as a congregation can come together in weird circumstances and still yet be connected and united because we are a part of the church. We are the church. And we believe that we have the power to make a difference. So, Father, we ask that you will continue to be with us. Let us worship you this morning. Amen.
Into the darkness and shine. Friends, anger is a natural emotion that we all have. Tracy spoke a couple of months ago about forgiveness and how we need to choose to forgive people to release us from the bondage that unforgiveness puts us under. We've recorded that message in YouTube if you want to go and watch it. When somebody hurts us and hurts us deep to our core, we want them to feel some type of the hurt and pain that they've caused us. We want revenge. We want to get even. And these are all ways that we misdirect our anger in the wrong direction. As we were working through the Plan B series that we finished a couple weeks ago, this thought about anger came to my mind. And when I was reminded about the sermon on forgiveness, the feeling and thoughts came stronger of, what about when people are angry with God? What do we do with that? Is it okay to be angry with God and to question Him? This is something a lot of people don't talk about because either they're embarrassed and don't want people to look down on them, or they don't want people to think that they've lost their faith. This morning, I want to open up a conversation and look into the Bible to see if people were angry with God and how they dealt with it. I think there are a lot more people out there that are angry with God than we actually know. First, we need to look at some of the reasons why we displace our anger towards God. Some of them could be a death of a parent or parents we feel too soon or at all. Marriage breakdowns. We don't get married intending for it not to work out. Poor health physically. You feel like God is not listening to your prayers of healing. Mental health. The question of why would you let this happen to me and where are you? A loss of a child or a miscarriage. Infertility. Financial problems. Can't find a job. Or maybe you're unhappy in your job. Addictions. Maybe you have been hurt by the church. Seems like everything you do and touch just seems to go wrong. Like God just doesn't have your back. There are probably many more that we could list. Why do we feel this way? Why do we feel like giving up at times? It may be because we think as though God has forgotten about us and just plainly forsaken the earth. We don't doubt His existence or His reality. There's a quote in the movie God's Not Dead, and it says this: how can you be mad at something that doesn't exist? But our prayers seem to go unanswered. We cry out for His help in such desperation, and it doesn't seem like He hears us. We struggle along. What I worry about is that if this anger goes on too long and you feel like you haven't heard from God, you might end up giving up on Him and walking away at some point. What do we do with this? There are many places in the Bible where we see people angry with God or plainly questioning Him. Jonah is one that comes to mind right off the top. The only time he seems to be happy through the whole entire book was when God grew some shade over his head from the scorching sun. The book ends with him being very angry with no resolve. God ends the book of Jonah with a question and no answer by saying to Jonah, "Don't you feel sorry for the people of Nineveh?" There's a lot of anger there. What about the question towards Jesus with Mary and Martha when their brother Lazarus had died? As Jesus showed up to their town, they said to him, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." Essentially, they're saying to him, "Why didn't you come earlier? You didn't come on time. You could have saved his life." They were being very blunt with Jesus, and probably out of anger and some desperation. Jeremiah gets angry with God in chapter 20, verses 7. "O Lord, you deceived me, and I was deceived." And if we look through the Psalms, there are many instances where the psalmists show anger and questioning towards God. The one psalm that really jumped out to me was Psalm 77, which is a psalm we're going to look at this morning. Asaph was the one who penned this psalm. He was a worship leader for Israel, a famous and skilled musician who King David had appointed him chief of the Levites who provided music at the ceremony held when the Ark of the Covenant was brought back to Jerusalem. Asaph wrote 11 of the Psalms recorded in the Bible and was instrumental in many others. Let's read Psalm 77, verses 1 to 3. I cried out to God for help. I cried out to God to hear me. When I was in distress, I sought the Lord. At night, I stretched out untiring hands, and I would not be comforted. I remembered you, God, and I groaned. I meditated, and my spirit grew faint. We can see right in the beginning of the psalm that something was wrong, or went wrong. He was not in a good place in his life. It seemed very dark. He doesn't share where his grief is coming from, but it is definitely there. Have you been in this place in your life? Are you there right now? He is crying out to God. He shouts for God as he gets more agitated and wants him to listen to him. He doesn't think that God is listening, so he yells louder. He is searching, but he can't seem to find him. He feels like he is abandoned by God. Instead of thoughts of God giving him peace in this situation, he feels more anguish with his groaning, feeling like nothing can calm the storm in his life. We too can get into a place, and it is an uncomfortable, unsettling place to be with anxiousness, unresolved, and maybe a feeling of unloved. So overwhelmed at where we are in our life at this time. Maybe you've been in this place for a while and you don't know where to go with these feelings. Let's read verses 4 and 5. You kept my eyes from closing. I was too troubled to speak. I thought about the former days, the years of long ago. In these verses, he is continuing to lament about his situation. Maybe he hasn't slept for days or weeks or maybe even months over his trouble. He keeps looking back at the glory days and how everything he did was with a joyful song. Then he started to think of why his situation is different at this point. We do that, don't we? We look back and we remember how everything was so good and why are these things happening to us right now? We have a great memory of the way we want to see them in the past. Maybe it wasn't all joyful in the past, but when we're in the middle of a storm in our life, all we can think of is either the way it was or how can we get out of it. We then see some poignant questions surface towards God. Has the Lord rejected us forever? Will he never again be kind to me? Is his unfailing love gone forever? Have his promises permanently failed? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he slammed the door on compassion? Wow, these are powerful questions. And can you relate to any of them? The formulation of the questions has a therapeutic effect. Doubts and questions are expressed by the greatest men of the God in the Old Testament, and even by our Lord Jesus on the cross. Quoting Psalm 22:1, My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Matthew 27:46. Similarly, the psalmist asks whether God will reject his people forever by not extending that to them his favor. These questions go from the present situation to rejection in verse 7. Will the Lord reject forever? Will he never show his favor again to the cause of the Lord's anger in verse 9? Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has he in anger withheld his compassion? The psalmist's despair turns godly when it turns Godward. Something awesome has to happen when we choose to direct line to the Lord. Dr. Dan Allender says, the irony of questioning God is that it honors him. It turns our hearts away from ungodly despair toward a passionate desire to comprehend him. The psalmist's questions serve as a reality check, exposing any fantasy we hold of a blissful world with no problems. And lastly, these questions are not penned by a sobering psalmist. These utterances are words of God For the word of God is living and active, Hebrews 4:12. When we wrap our anguish around a biblical psalm, we're searching for him. And when we seek, we will find him. Our psalmist admits to it and says, I complained. As I read through the text, it almost appears as though Asaph is about to lose it. Anybody ever been there? You feel like you're about to lose it? Maybe if you just lose it for a minute or two, you'll feel better. You're at your breaking point. Nobody better say a word to you. Don't even look at me the wrong way. I'm about to lose it. But notice what happens in our text. He is intentionally trying to refocus his mind. Asaph uses the term, I will, three times. Verses 11 to 12. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will consider all your works and meditate on all your mighty deeds. When we read the first 9 verses, for a moment we thought he is going to lose all hope. But verse 10 turns it all around. He refuses to focus on his situation. He refused to continue to complain because he knows God has not changed. We changed. Circumstances changed, but God will not change. The real issue, if we don't turn our minds towards him and try to refocus on the blessings, we can get stuck in the trap that we might never be able to climb out. We then see Asaph start to worship God through his struggles. He has changed his direction. He says, God, you are holy. There is no other God as powerful as you. You perform miracles. You show your holy power to everyone. Then Asaph talks about the protection he had on them in the Exodus. What an amazing change in attitude, and I think it's important for us to do the same, because we take the focus off of ourselves and put the focus on God. I think if most of us were honest, we can look back at times when God really was blessing us and how great it was to fellowship with him and follow his ways. He has worked mightily in our lives. And when we do this, we come to the same conclusion Asaph did in verses 13 to 15. Your ways, God, are holy. What God is as great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the people. With your mighty arm, you redeem your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph. That God's way is holy. That word can have many meanings. Other translations read, your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. God's way is pure and perfect for us. It is different from the ways of man. It is far above the ways of man. Isaiah 55:9 tells us that God's ways are higher than man's ways, and it might not look great to us. We may not understand it. We still don't get it. But God does get it. His way for us is holy. His way for us is best. And to show how great God is, Asaph goes on to focus on God's biggest act of deliverance yet. God's leading Israel out of slavery to freedom with crossing the Red Sea. I won't go into details on that. You can read it in the account of Exodus 14. God's people had been under Egyptian slavery for 400 years. Under the leadership of Moses and Aaron, God took them out of Egypt to safety. At Moses' command, he parted the Red Sea, and then he closed it back over the Egyptians, where none of them made it through. In the rest of the psalm, verses 16 to 20, we see Asaph describing what it would have been like to be there when God parted the Red Sea. Look down at verse 19. God's way in the sea. Your path led through the sea, your way through the mighty waters, though your footprints were not seen. God's way is in the sea. We often want God to take our problems and difficulties away. We would rather not have any problems or difficulties at all. But God's way, remember, it is holy, often includes problems. But he doesn't leave us there. He takes us right through to the other side. He is our deliverer. Look at what verse 20 says. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. God cared for his people through Moses and Aaron. He does this to show us he loves us and he cares for us. No matter what situation you might be facing, God does understand. He does get it, and he is the one who will still care for us and safely sees us through to the other side. This is what he did for Israel, and this is what he'll do for you and for me. You may feel rejected. You may feel abandoned. Your faith may be weak. You think you are down for the count. Sorrow, tears, pain, and emptiness may swallow you up at times, but God is still on the throne. He is still God. When you are in despair or discouragement and you don't get it, tell God you don't get it. It's okay if you have questions, but instead of keeping your focus on your problems, look to him. Look at how he has been faithful and taking care of you. He still does. And even though what is happening to you makes no sense, it does to God. When you don't get it, he does get it. Then you will be able to write a psalm of praise for his faithfulness and deliverance in your life as well. I'm probably not giving you the answer you need this morning for the reasons you are angry at God. I do want you to caution to not stay in that place of anger. Gut-wrenching questions, honor God. Despair directed at God is a way of encountering him, opening ourselves up to the one and only someone who can actually do something about our difficulties. Let us this morning turn towards God with our anger and questions and leave it with him, so we do not hinder our relationship with him. Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much for your faithfulness, your grace, and your mercy on each one of us who is listening to this. I thank you for your word, the living and active word that shows us the heart of you and your love for each one of us. I thank you that you gave us your son, Jesus, to live within us and given us the Holy Spirit to work within us. Father, right now, I just pray if there's anyone listening to this that has anger towards you, that's questioning, that they open their minds to see you for who you are, that they're able to come to you, that their sorrow can be turned into praise, that their anger can be turned into joy, that you are a God who delivers people. You are our God. And so, God, I just ask that you bless those who are struggling. Bless those who need you right now. Give them a presence that they can only understand that comes from you. Be with each one of us. In your name we pray. Amen. Bless you, church. We'll see you next week.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. And you have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. And you have been so, so kind to me. foe, still your love fought for me. And you have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. And you have been so, so kind. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down,